witness is the 1831 DeWitt Clinton locomotive, the third locomotive built in the United States. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. Built for the Mohawk and Hudson Railroad, not only would this be the third steam locomotive built in the U.S., it'd actually be the first one to operate in the state of New York. It was named after the popular governor of New York, DeWitt Clinton, who had earlier in his career spearheaded the effort to build the Erie Canal. The Erie Canal opened just 5 years before this locomotive was built. The Mohawk and Hudson, in building this locomotive, promised to cut travel time from Albany to Schenectady from the 2 to 3 days it took to travel by canal, which was often a result of the dozen or more locks you'd have to travel through and delays on the locks, down to only a couple of hours by rail. So the first test firing of this locomotive occurred on July 30th, 1831, and they test fired it with Lackawanna coal. Partly as a result of the coal they chose, it only achieved a top speed of an astounding 7 miles per hour, which was just too slow. A few days later, on August 3rd, 1831, they switched the fuel over to coke. Coke was a commonly used fuel in England for locomotives, less so in the States at that time. It's essentially coal with the impurities burned out, so it burns much hotter, much cleaner. And running on coke, they were able to achieve a speed of an average speed between 9 and 10 miles per hour. This allowed them to run their first passenger run on August 9th of 1831. With three Gould cars. They made the run in 38 minutes at an average of 25 to 27 miles per hour at a maximum speed of 30 miles per hour. So what are these Gould cars anyway? They look like stagecoaches they just slapped train wheels onto. Well, the Gould cars were just stagecoaches that they slapped train wheels onto, basically. They were built by John Gould of Albany, and effectively they are standard stagecoaches. The wheels were swapped out, the hitches were changed out, and this is what a lot of early railroads ran for passenger cars. Passengers would ride either inside or on top. You have seating up on top, obviously. You have seating front and back, as well as seating inside. These could hold quite a lot of people, as we'll see shortly. Each car was also equipped with its own brake here. It's this large lever on the back. That connects mechanically up here to the braking system. So the engines have brakes, and each car also had a manually operated brake. Could be operated by somebody riding on the back. Take a look at how these connect together. So you have the curved end of the wood frame on each car. That allows them to go around corners without hitting the ends. And they're connected by a solid chain in the middle. Well, initially, that's how they were built as well. But in the beginning, that chain was longer on their first run, and made a little bit longer chain, give a little more play to the system. And the problem they ran into with that is that when they'd first start out or when they'd stop, the cars would jerk so hard it'd actually throw passengers from their seats. On the first test run, when they stopped to get water, they went out and stole fence posts from near the water stop. And they lashed the fence post in between the cars to shorten that distance. And that made it considerably safer. It eliminated most of that jerking. Now, if you've seen stagecoaches before, you know they actually did come with some shock absorption protection here.
And that's in the form of these big leather straps. So the entire carriage actually rode on these leather straps, which worked similar to springs. Took the worst of the bounce out of the ride. Although realistically on railroads, they were smooth enough, you didn't have nearly the problem you did on carriages. So the ride was probably not too bad. Beyond that though, these Gould cars, effectively, were just like stagecoaches. The line officially opened to passenger service on September 24th, 1831. It provided a much faster way to move around New York than the Erie Canal, although not so great for cargo, but for passengers, obviously. And believe it or not, they scrapped the line 2 years later in 1833. Locomotive technology had just improved that fast that it just wasn't worth keeping anymore. This replica here in the Henry Ford Museum was actually built in 1893 by the New York and Central Railroad, which was the successor to the Mohawk and Hudson. So the replica was built to take around to various railroad fairs and festivals. These were incredibly popular in the late 1800s, early to mid 1900s. And the New York and Central, being a fairly sizable railroad at that point, was certainly very active at these events. Here's a photo from the 1904 Louisiana Purchase Exposition. And here from 1915, we have the General Electric film, King of the Rails. The DeWitt Clinton traveled extensively until 1934, when it was sold to the Henry Ford Museum. But that didn't end its travel. One of the conditions of the sale was that the railroad could continue to use it for promotional use, and New York Central still used it quite a lot. Here's a promotional film from the 1948 Chicago Railroad Fair entitled Wheels Are Rollin'.
This DeWitt Clinton also was built at the West Point Foundry for the Mohawk and Hudson Railroad, the pioneer unit of the later New York Central system. These curious coaches were made by a Mr. Gould, master stagecoach builder of the old city of Albany.
So in the 1950s, the DeWitt Clinton finally stopped traveling, after more than 60 years of traveling to festivals and fairs all over the country. If you're counting, that's 30 times longer than the original actually was in service. And it retired here to the Henry Ford Museum, where you can still see it today. Today people come by, and you've been hearing lots of kids in the background from field trips. It's educating people today on the history of steam, on the history of railroads, and with luck, it'll continue to do so for decades to come. And that's why this is the Industrial Revolution. Hey, before you go, I do need your help to keep this channel growing. Easiest thing you can do is just like or subscribe to the video. That tells YouTube, hey, this channel is worth watching. It'll show it to more people. Other thing you can do, completely free, is just leave a comment. More than two or three words is all it takes, and that counts as YouTube interaction. That's the strongest signal you can send to YouTube to recommend a channel to other people. Beyond that, if you can help out, This channel is actually fairly expensive to run. I usually drive 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours each way to get to these sites. So it can get pretty expensive. If you can help out with that, I have a Patreon page over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution. There's monthly memberships over there. Or if you're interested in just a one-time contribution to help out, just hit the super thanks button on this video. Thanks for watching. I'll see you at the next one.